Good morning and welcome everyone to this national webinar on medical education. This is our third national webinar of this series. The topic for today's webinar is teaching learning methods to cultivate skills for patient-centered care, delivered by Professor K.R. Sethuraman, Dean of Asian Institute of Medical Science and Technology Malaysia, Medicine Science and Technology Malaysia. The reason for choosing this topic is that we all know that an Indian medical graduate is expected to perform five important roles such as clinician, communicator, leader of a healthcare team, lifelong learner, and a professional. Among these five roles, the role of professional is very crucial for a medical professional. One of the most important domain of medical professionalism is patient-centered care or patient-centered professionalism. It is a known fact that teaching professionalism in a formal way is a great challenge to our educators. The speaker for today is Dr. K.R. Sethuraman, who will share his thoughts on patient-centered care and its importance in medical education. About our speaker, Professor Sethuraman needs no introduction, but still it is my duty and is a custom that as a host, I have to introduce him. Professor Sethuraman is currently the Dean and Senior Professor of Medicine at Asian Institute of Medicine, Science and Technology, Malaysia. He was the former Professor of Medicine and HOD of Medical Education, JIPMA. He was the former Vice Chancellor of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, Puducherry. He has authored 9 books and more than 50 publications in scientific journals. He has guided 6 PhD students in health professional education. With this short introduction, I now invite Dr. Professor Sethuraman to deliver his talk. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jayaprakash, and good morning to all those in India, and good afternoon to all those from Malaysia, Singapore, and this zone where we already had our lunch and we are sitting in the post-lunch session. And it's good to connect back with the National Teacher Training Center, now upgraded as Department of Medical Education in its 45th year, because it started in 1975. I'm happy to be associated with that, because out of my 40 years in JIPMA, the second half, 22nd innings, so to say, that 86 to 2006, 20 years was as a part of NTTC family. I know Bharati, Anbarag, and all those people for a long time now. So quite nostalgic day for me to share the screen with the whole platform. National Teacher Training Center. So let me start with the talk with a common scene, which we often see. The doctor, in listening to the auscultatory finding, misses the clue, important clues that the patient is going to was about to say. So this is a common problem, and it was well observed. Through an ocular aphorism, listen to the patient, for he is telling you the diagnosis. So this is a typical way many of us interrupt a patient, preoccupation with disease and technology, and ignorance or unawareness or disinterest in patient's own concerns and his or her agenda. So this generally has been leading over the decades to less of patient trust and respect for medicine in general. So that is what Osler wants, and it's not new. Even I'm dedicating this talk to an ancient role model, physician Charaka and William Osler, who was given very quotable quotes on holistic approach to patient care. That is entering the body of the patient with lamp of knowledge and understanding. That is very colorfully put by in. Classical Indian, ancient Indian way, and more modern direct way by Osler. Much more important to know what sort of patient has a particular disease than what sort of disease the patient has. So it these will test the stand of time forever. So with those role models in mind, I have 6 agendas today to share with you over the next 40 minutes or so. Introduce the concept of PCC or patient-centered care from the viewpoint of various stakeholders, the administration, the healthcare professionals, the nursing staff, the patients, the students, and the public. So and to discuss PCC as a system at macro, meso, and micro level, and to highlight the importance of humanistic approach as a great motivator that drives the patient care, patient-centered care, and to discuss the communication strategies which help mediate and deliver. That is a vehicle, and the humanism is the driver. That is how I'm conceptualizing this model for today. And to consider various options for teaching learning of patient-centered care. And finally, to share a notable improvement in patient satisfaction when the PGs are effectively trained in patient-centered skills. This is based on the research that was awarded PhD in January 2020, current one of the PhDs that was done by my team. So let us start with this concept of patient-centered care from different stakeholders. And of course, each one is interested in one the area that is felt by them or perceived by them. So like blind man and the elephant gives part of the picture, but together that you can form a holistic view. That's why I'm sharing different viewpoints. And the first is administrative viewpoint. Patients are equal partners and active participants. That is attribute. And based on that, they have four cardinal principles of patient-centered care from PCC hospital administrations. That is personalized or individualized is one. Coordinated care, coordinated among primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary care, and at outpatient, inpatient, and ICU levels like that. So vertical, horizontal, coordinated, and enabled. Patient and the family caretakers at home have to be enabled to continue care. And most important, the fourth one is the care is offered with dignity, compassion, and respect to the patient and his family. And National Health Service UK has put it very, this is, I shared this because this is a very common thing that we Indians like six C's, competence, commitment, compassion, communication, courage, and care is the concept of patient-centered care of National Health Service UK. What do professionals feel, medical and other healthcare professionals? They say this doctor, so first one, doctor sees the patient through a biopsychosocial perspective to share power and responsibility and to form effective therapeutic alliance. That is the utopian ideal model of patient-provider dyad or doctor-patient, patient-centered care in a doctor-patient relationship mode. And now from biopsychosocial, which is well known to us, actually, in the past 10 years, they are now saying somato-psychosocial semiotic. Semiotic has been added. I will explain more of this later. So biopsychosocial has been expanded to this new SPSS. SPSS is a new coinage for that. Okay, what do doctors, what do senior nurses feel about the spectrum of doctors and who is patient-centered, who is not? So this is a very nice one. I would like you to go through. This link is available. You can read the full article, very funny. And that nurse is quite open about it. Some doctors were debonair and boisterous. Some were friendly. Some were snobs. Some were science nerds who knew all the science but couldn't deal with the patient or their relatives. So awkward. Then, of course, she mentions a lot about the perfect doctor. Dr. Franklin is the one. Kind, patient, never rude, up to date, very experienced, and the best bedside manner. And he practiced wheeling the heart attack patient himself directly to ICU bed and tucking the patient to bed, what normally nurses do, all the while comforting the worried patient and his family. So that was a very nice layperson's explanation of what patient-centered care is all about. Okay, now the reverse. What about the patients that we medical professionals prefer to have? Would you like to have the first group, level one, who are very passive and say, my doctor is in charge of my health? or would you prefer a person who is trying to become a little more accountable for self-care? I could be doing a little more. And I'm a part of healthcare team, that is level 3, where they actively participate. And level 4 is, I am my own advocate. So they are totally autonomous individuals. So we get all sorts of patients, and we have to align ourselves how to communicate and give patient-centered care regardless of the type. It is ideal to have level 3 for ideal therapeutic relationship. Okay, then what do patients expect when you say patient-centered care? There is a study on that also published in 2011. And they have classified into what is reasonable or and what is unreasonable from doctor's perspective. The need to listen and the need to receive clear explanation, to be treated with respect and to be treated competently. So these are quite reasonable, whereas the other one is debatable. Getting a prescription without consultation, which is common in India, even a pharmacist does it. Ability to call a physician anytime, 24/7, for any kind of problem. So, and third is, as soon as the first consultation happens in the first 5 minutes, the doctor should be omniscient, omnipotent, so that he or she can give the exact diagnosis and also treat the exact treatment on the first day after 10 minutes. So that is unrealistic expectation in complicated cases. So I move on to the second part of the part one, that is PCC as a system. System, as all of us know, is interconnected, interdependent parts working to form a functioning whole, and it serves a common goal. So patient care, patient-centered care should be a system in an institution like JIPMER and every other place, where there is a structure with these 7 components. I'm not going to read them. And this slide share already has this whole set, so there is no need to photograph or copy or anything. I'll give the link afterwards. Then second is the process. It's a form and the function. Form is the structure, function is the process. And third is, of course, outcome. What does the system do as its outcome? It gives patient-centered care, and it looks at patient-reported outcomes. That is more important than professional-reported outcomes. Okay. So then, if you want to create a system, then top hospitals like JIPMER, All India Institute, CMC, etc., they have to enable by adopting this critical enablers. Like information technology, the infrastructure that lends to patient-centered care. Many of the outpatients won't even have enough chairs, so that patients will have to squat on the ground or stand outside on hot sun. So that shouldn't happen if it's patient-centered critical enabler. Incentive systems, contracting strategies, and cultural change. These three I will condense as one example, because I have been out of India since 2006. Except a short 5-year period in between. So in up to 2009-10, I used to find that in most hospitals, including JIPMER, when poor patients come, there are hardly anything available. So if things are not available, we say you find money and go to some place. Otherwise, it's difficult to manage and all that. But when JIPMER got the autonomy status and a lot of budget, that is one change. And the other one is CM insurance scheme in Tamil Nadu. So I find that even in all state, taluk and district hospitals, so upgraded in the past 10 years, it's unbelievable. I went to Tanjore and I went to Thoothukudi medical colleges. The medical gastroenterology is like a corporate, 5-star corporate setup, because they earn so much through insurance. They don't know how to spend the money, they said. Every year they buy new equipment. The whole floor is nicely ceramic tiled and air conditioned, and patients are happy, the team is happy. So it is because of the infrastructure, the incentive schemes, the contracting strategies, and finally contributes to cultural change. So it is not a dreary old civil hospital where you go only if you are poor and you cannot pay. It is no more like that. So you can get high quality and cost containment through this CM insurance scheme. So this is reality which I have seen over the past 15 years. I hope more states adopt this and more nations adopt this. Okay, now we move on to what students feel about patient-centered care. There is a paper on this also. And basically they want to know why, the purpose of being patient-centered. Why can't I be professional-oriented and paternalistic? So that has to be explained to them. What is the personal benefit for being patient-centered? Secondly, understanding what it is about the ontology or what is patient care, patient-centered care, PCC. And thirdly, factors that influence adoption in a positive way and a negative way so that they can promote the positive aspects and try to curb the negative forces that undermine patient-centered care. And now, with your permission, let me move on to part two, that is the relevance of the driver and the vehicle that can carry and deliver compassionate patient-centered care. As I said earlier, humanism is the driver and the vehicle is the communication system. It was well succinctly told by Dr. Peabody, a Harvard physician who was a role model himself. The secret of care of the patient is in caring for the patient, very simply put, and his landmark articles are still widely cited and widely read, so you can click the link and download those articles. Worth reading even today. And according to humanistic physicians, they say professional behavior is the tip of the iceberg that is visible. What is not visible and hidden is the hidden portion of the iceberg. 80%, that is internalized humanistic value system that adopts the worldview, the personal beliefs, values, etc., and then ultimately it shows as professional behavior. So, professionalism or the behavior is the setting, behaving according to what is expected of an Indian medical graduate, let's say, what MCI says, or what Indian Medical Association says. So, that is professionalism. Humanism is personal, deep seated conviction about our own obligation towards others who need help. So here again, this section will be full of stories, so permit me the time and privilege of sharing it with you. So this is a senior surgeon who came to Jipmer in 1994, I think. While returning to drop him in airport, I sat with him and went to Chennai. So after some time, we became quite close and friendly. So he told me the story. I'll just actually one of the chapters in my book Trick or Treat, which is downloadable from Google. This is the laborer Murki who got operated by the famous senior surgeon in KEM, I think, for some acute abdomen. And then he was extremely happy and said, "One day I will repay you for your kindness." So, surgeon is of course very well-meaning and a professional person, and he just, you know, demigod in his own, because he is so much respected and liked by all his patients. He laughed affably and said, "What can this bloke do to me?" And sent him off. I tapped him and said, "Don't bother," and sent him off. 2 months later, when there were Mumbai riots, no post Ayodhya, a mob stopped the surgeon's car and were about to attack him. Then Murki was in the vicinity. He came, ran to the place and stopped the crowd and said, "He is a surgeon. He saves lives. Don't harm him and all." So pacified them and saved the day. So that was a great moment of enlightenment for the surgeon. He said, "It was a near-death experience for me. I thought I would be leashed by the mob. When this boy took me to safety, I felt he was God in human form. He seemed omnipotent. Then he realized how patients perceive him when they come with acute abdomen and his routine professional work looks like perfect angel helping them live a second lease of life, etc. So he changed. So should everybody undergo this experience, or do we learn from the surgeon's narrative? So that is a question we have to ask our students. So humanism versus professionalism. So basically, humanism is who one is, and it drives authentic professional behaviors, harder to undermine even when under duress and when no one is watching. Whereas professionalism, what we do to show up our competence, can even be a robotic professional doing it automatically. And when we are stressed for time or under duress and when no one is watching, then we undermine. So professional life is not about acting in front of the patient, true to him or her. It's about remaining true to the patient even when they are not there at all times. So one more story on humanism. This mainly I'm sharing because I thought narratives are a very effective way of transforming students' perceptions and making them adopt a change in behavior. Young man, this patient was treated in Jaipur in 1971 to 73. I was in final year, and when he died, I was in first year PG. So I know him for 3 years. He had all this lassitude, etc., etc., because of his blood cancer, no, CML. He didn't know that. So his wife left him, and because he was impotent and he was breathless, couldn't do his earn his daily life. So he wanted to consume rat killer poison and died. So whatever money he had, he could buy only one pack of rat killer. So he took that. What happened is he vomited once and woke up. So when he went to the shopkeeper, he told him, "Hey, you need to take 20 packs to kill yourself, man. You never asked me. One will kill only a rat, not a human being." So he was so depressed. This is what he told me. "I felt I am so poor, I can't even kill myself." Then he walked all the way from Kadalur to Jaipur, 20 kilometers, and fainted at the bus station when he landed in front. Then somebody brought him to casualty, we admitted, and then took care of his leukemia until he died 2 years later. So treating the man for chronic myeloid leukemia until he passed away was professionalism, which is practiced day in and day out by Jaipur. But what is not known to many people is the Jaipur students also gave emotional support, got him a job in the hospital mess, and until he died. So that is evidence of humanism. So now attitude also varies. Humanistic physicians are not a single one-size-fits-all kind of thing. There is a surgeon's cohort and a medical physician's cohort. Humility, professional standard behavior, and responsibility to patient, that is common for both so humanistic professionals. But having fun and then paying it forward means leaving a legacy with trainees, and low prioritization of work-life balance. All work and no life is surgeon's dominant trait, and curiosity, active role modeling, and striving to achieve work-life balance is more of physician's domain. This is one study reported in recently, 2019. You can download this article. So, to end, what if students ask, how can I cultivate my humanistic sensitivity, means they have to follow the rule of reciprocity. Do unto others as you would have done, would have them do unto you. So this is a little difficult, a mouthful and a tongue twister as well. So it's easier to ask this way. Would I like my near and dear treated thus? So that is a much easier way of self-reflection whenever a patient sits in front of us. If he was my elder, my peer, my children, would I handle like this? Okay. So now let me move on to the from humanism to communication skills. This is a real scene I have cartoonized from obstetrics OPD some 30-40 years back, I don't know when. long back. Intern asked this question. Are you married? No. How many children? She got angry and went and complained to the ONG head sitting inside. So then she advised this young intern, don't worry, ask the questions the other way around. So she explained. Okay. So what happened to the next patient? Do you have kids? Yes, I do. Are you married? Then she got really wild, was about to slap him. Then the HOD had to intervene, and then what happened is he said, don't talk to patients, you only take down dictation. So you are shifted inside to become clerk for the professor, taking down whatever pelvic exam, abdominal exam findings. So this is repeatedly happens every year, every batch. I hear this kind of stories shared by my friends and colleagues. Routine communication out of context can land one in trouble. And this is not only in JIPMER or not only in India. It's a global phenomenon. This is called, there's a longitudinal study. It's a cross-sectional study among different population. And it's published in 2005. You can download this article. It says this hourglass model, that's what they say. When they enter in year one MBBS, they are quite holistic in their approach. But when they come to final year internship, that zone, that is like neck of the hourglass, they only want to pass the exam. So they end up collecting one-sided collection of medical facts and avoid rapport building with the patient as a waste of precious time. This they call it as instrumental strategy. You have to learn medical anthropology and sociology to understand this jargon. So, but one-sided collection of facts and avoiding rapport building is good enough. But unfortunately, it is not a narrow neck. It is a very long neck, as the other study, 2005 study in medical teacher, has shown. Even after 10 years of clinical experience, senior registrars were no better than third year medicos in these some of the areas of communication. How to initiate a session with the patient, how to build rapport, how to question some aspects, how to smoothly transition from one to the other, how to follow timeline, how to organize the various data that you collect, and how to document it with specificity and verifiability. So these are weak points even after 10 years. So therefore, it means that communication skills, both spoken and written, must be formally trained in medical schools. At least the top schools like JIPMER and all should be role models in this. And key communication skills must be embedded in curricula, like listening to patient story, exploring patient's ideas, agenda, and giving emotional support, and how to give information in a clear, concise way, how to find common ground for treatment and plan for investigation, how to enable the patient to shared decision making, even if they are illiterate, and how to implement adequate balance between biopsychosocial issues and semiotic issues. Okay, one way is empathic communication with scientific approach. It's a mouthful, but what it means is first you mentally prepare to talk to the patient. Depending on, so you have to read the case record, find out what is the context, what is the age, what is the literacy, etc. So we align ourselves with that. And then linger on patient's narrative. Think about it and contemplate what is a hidden message, what is an explicit message, using active listening. And co-create narrative. I'll just give an example. This patient was in dermatology ward sometime in 1975, I think. In JIPMER, I've seen this patient repeatedly. A man in late 40s with granuloma venereum, a sexually transmitted disease. And he was demanding transfer to surgery ward. No, it is in the same floor, one ward, 34 or 32 or 36 ward he wanted to shift for penile amputation. He was demanding, amputate my penis, I want to go home. So how to manage this guy? So I was in a dermatology posting at that time. So I went through the thing and actually after talking to him, found out, listening to the narrative, his wife died of carcinoma cervix 2 years, 3 years earlier, I think. And after a period of mourning, what happened is he was too old to get remarried. So he started visiting commercial sex workers for his release of his libido. Then unfortunately, he got granuloma venereum. So then what happened is he's partly guilty. It's a complex one. I'm not a psychiatrist to analyze and tell what was. Basically, his anxiety neurosis was, on one hand, that it's contagion from his wife's cancer. And second thing is, because his penis is there, he is doing all this mischief and getting into trouble. So best is to amputate. So that seems to be the hidden agenda for him. So how to co-create a narrative? Then I said, okay, give me 20 days time. I'll give injection to dissolve that tumor or whatever you call that. If it still persists, then we'll amputate. I never said that we won't amputate. I was very sure that with 10 days of twice a day injection of streptomycin, it will disappear. So he agreed. So kept him for 10 days, finished the told sister. In dermatology anyway, there is no pressure for beds at that time at least. So completed the course and he totally healed. Then he said, you are all gods, angels and all that, and he went. So we could have been quite rude to him, brutal to him, or cynical with him, or scolded him and all that. So empathic communication with scientific approach is possible. We have to take time to understand why things are happening and not just label him as mad fellow. He wants penile amputation. What the hell, man? So it doesn't help that way. So this is an example of empathic communication with scientific approach. Link between patient-centered communication and various outcomes. This is what students should know. They wanted to know why learn PCC. This one summarizes that, this paper of 2010. Teaching PCC to students, immediate outcome is there, intermediate outcome is there, and final long-term outcome. Quality of life, well-being, survival, etc. I used to tell this also, but when I thought about it, I suddenly remembered a case that I had seen in rounds sometime in 1985, mid-80s, during rounds. I used to teach PGs how to give exit interview with the discharging patients. So on bronchiectasis fellow in his early 20s was discharged. So I spent 5-10 minutes maximum. Not more than 10 minutes, giving advice on tracheobronchial toilet and how to recognize recurrent infections and early treatment at home with tetracycline for 5 days and come to Jipmer only if he doesn't get that. So all that was given and on slip, everything was written and sent to him. Maximum it would have been 10 minutes. And then I meet him in 2010, 25 years later in the bank when I came from Malaysia to Jipmer Bank. That fellow that was there, and he came running and said, sir, do you remember me? And of course, he had changed a lot. I couldn't recollect. And he introduced that he used to attend a chest clinic every month. And all his peers, in spite of him telling, do tracheal toilet and all that, they didn't do. And then they are all dead and gone or got carpal manali and quite worse off now. But he is still quite active, and he never had a hospital admission. After the third admission, discharge advice. So that shows the power of just 10 minutes of talking to patients, something relevant to them, and empowering them to take care of themselves so that there is longevity, well-being, improved survival, quality of life. So these are stories that we can tell students to motivate them, that don't discharge them, just say go on. They'll just put in a TCA after 2 weeks. Many people won't even know what is TCA. Each college, each has its own short forms like that. Okay. So now the last portion, TL strategies. This is the talk actually, but this takes only 10 minutes. So since Jayaprakash gave me 1 hour, I thought I'll expand a little bit. So now I'll come to the main talk, very brief one on TL strategies for holistic approach, communication skills, and patient-centered care with compassion. Even senior physicians miss it out. This is actually a courier boy. He has already been undressed and he is being examined. Let me know if you want to know why I am here. So, this happens And every time we this cartoon is shown, somebody will ask, where is patient-centered or person-centered care in our medical curriculum? It wasn't there in explicit manner, though it was implied in 1997 curriculum. But it was made explicit in IMG, the vision document of MCI recently. That is a landmark document. Even Malaysia is now using it as a model document, and they are reforming the whole thing now. Our competency-based model of MCI is making waves in Malaysia also. So first contact family physician, Jayaprakash already introduced, and the two communication core skills are also mentioned in the document. So for that, the curriculum, whole curriculum has to be changed from year one to internship. It can be done by innovative colleges like JIPMER, it is possible to do. So adopt this somato, psycho, socio, semiotic model. So biopsychosocial is the other one. Bio is called as somatic. So biopsychosocial model we already know. Semiotic means the patient has to make sense of the illness. They always, when we get sick, they say, why did I get sick? Why now? Why me? Why now? Is always looking for meaning, making sense of the illness. So that is called semiosis, part of medical anthropology and medical sociology. And it has to be in the common parlance of every hospital, regardless of what healthcare technician, optometrist, allied health, general practice, pharmacist, a postgraduate social worker, all should be aware of this somato, psychosocial, semiotic model of health so that we can offer holistic patient care solutions. And what subjects to add in our syllabus, every time we say, where does the syllabus fit in? Okay, that is also stated by in this paper. Somatic is the anatomy, physiology, paraclinical, clinical, all subjects will go there. Social, community medicine, already teaching a lot. Psychological, psychiatry teaches a little bit, but more of psychology is needed. And semiosis, who is going to teach? That is for JIPMER and other progressive institutions to decide. Who will teach the meaning of illness, understanding of illness, understanding of the life world in which patients live, and self-image of the patient. The classical example, the man who wanted his penis amputated, so that his self-image will be improved. So these are semiotic issues which are very important and which is a neglected area in the current curriculum. The conceptual model of learning environment that progressive medical colleges can adopt is to improve the personal learning space, the social learning connectivity and scaffolding, the physical and virtual space, which provides materials, learning resources, and organizational ethos that promote psychosocial and semiotic patient-centered care models. So, these are necessary, and it has to be done at, this is done at a macro, meso, and individual, micro levels. All three levels are involved. And everybody is baby, not just one. So the whole organization has to learn as a whole and as an individual. And the paradigm of education, the didactic mode isn't enough. We can use, adopt these models, to, like social constructivism can be taken up to emphasize human relationship, and best done through cognitive apprenticeship, that is clinical clerkship or internship or postgraduate period. Humanism is through self-reflection or portfolio-based assessment and transformation, emphasizing social justice, equity. And our doctors who go out of our medical colleges become agents of change. That is through critical reflection and dialogue and through stories and narratives. So that's why I gave several stories and narratives. Personally, I find the students remember stories even after 30, 40 years. In alumni meet, they tell, I still remember your stories. So teaching learning of communication style, it has to be based on hierarchy. So hierarchy means these green ones are easy, structured interview, eliciting info. The blue and lavender colored one is middle, and the Red ones are difficult ones, better taught during internship and postgraduate specialization rather than during early student days. So start with easier ones and progressively ascend up. This article is there in 2005 Medical Teacher. And Miller's pyramid, all the educationists who are attending know already. So you start from ex cathedra lessons, means the lessons, formal lesson or PowerPoint shared by the teacher concerned for reading and understanding. Then audiovisual aids for know-how and show-how through simulated patients or role play among students. And finally, they do it when they are interns and during postgraduate residency. So PL of communication skills have to be practiced. You shouldn't stop at level one, but you should ascend up to DAS. Similarly, didactic method is very efficient. One teacher can address 200, 300 students, but learners are passive and it is doesn't cause any much change in the behavior when the students go out. So please do not reduce IMG to just two lectures. It will never work. You will never create a utopian IMG that MCA is expecting. You have to adopt role modeling, use of standardized patients, real patients, and role play among the various students from first year to internship and even postgraduate time. So for them to internalize all this behavior and practice patient-centered care. But is it really useful? Is there any evidence, we ask? Personally, we did a research on this, doctoral research, 2015 to 18. Dr. Varsha Smurthy, doctoral work, I have given in the bottom as a reference. PhD was awarded in January this year, 2020, where most patients were satisfied. Complete denture treatment. Now, this is what all the dental people said. So we took that as our challenge. Improving patient satisfaction of completely edentulous patients for complete denture treatment. Do study before with the PGs who are in the second year, well qualified in the denture fitting. And after training intervention, see whether performance improves, patient satisfaction. So we use this model, phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four, phase five approach. And gave cognitive emotional space for the PG so that they didn't feel threatened. They were felt quite safe to share all their concerns with us. So Dr. Varsha was like elder sister, I was more like a parental figure. So we used to take care of the six postgraduates as our own family. And spent nearly 2 years with them, one and a half years to 2 years with them. And in-depth learning was provided during the intervention in a two-hour session, nine sessions of 2 hours each. That is copyrighted as ProPrep. You can contact Dr. Varsha, she is in Pondicherry. You can contact her and get it from her. So these are the elements we train the PGs on, how to foster patient rapport, how to gather info, how to provide info, how to reach decisions in a shared way, collaborative way, and how to take care of patient agenda so that we enable treatment success. So patient agenda was often far different from what doctor's agenda were, and they were not even aware of that in the first pre-intervention phase. So much so, we were remarkably surprised that the experimental group of patients ultimately were 8 times more satisfied, likely to report satisfaction as compared to before. I'll just explain half a minute this slide, this chi-square chart. 50 patients were taken up in the pre-intervention phase. 33 were not satisfied, 17 were satisfied. With the same technical skill as assessed by a blinded technical committee, after this 9 into 2 hour coaching session, 66 patients were done by the six PGs, and 13 only were less satisfied like before and the other group. Whereas 53, 4 times of the group were more satisfied, and only 1/4 were satisfied. So if you do a chi-square test, the odds ratio comes nearly eight times better. So this was a remarkable finding. So if you think spending 18 hours in a three-year curriculum is worth spending to improve patient satisfaction 8 times, please go ahead. We are there to help. We can share. ProPrep is cooperated and Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth in Pondicherry. I'm sure they'll be glad to share with you this cooperative material. So to sum up, with semantic search engines like Google and all that, providing all medical information to public at large, the only core skill that will help doctors thrive in 21st century is holistic patient-centered care. That is not possible through Google. You need a human being in front of you who is a medical professional or a healthcare professional who can take care of individualized care. So that such a empowered holistic PCC skilled care provider can provide humanistic professionalism and compassionate PCC care. And the four-year-old doctor study that we did showed that we could achieve patient satisfaction 8 times more than what the PGs could do before they underwent the training. So we are very happy personally that Medical Council of India has put the mandate on all the medical colleges to produce IMGs of high caliber with patient-centered care approach. So if all the teachers take a resolve, it is my job and to contribute in my own way to provide future doctors of whom we can be justifiably proud. Then I think the purpose of my talk will be done. The take-home message is just this slide. Basically, humanists ask queries to the patient about an individual patient who has this particular health problem. Whereas the other circle is current scientific evidence-based knowledge about that health problem that we diagnose in medicine. We have to learn how to overlap. That is where gurus, senior people come in handy, how to link humanistic individualized patient's concern along with the evidence-based medicine and reach a unique, individualized, scientific, humanistic, patient-centered care solution for the individual patient in front of you. It is possible if we apply our mind and we have to be role models so that the next generation will be better than us. In anticipation of 1997 document MCI, demand of communication skills. Now everybody will say, how will we teach? So I released the first edition in 2000. And in 2017, second edition has come in time for the IMG. So I put all the experience, including the teaching plan for every chapter. So the first 9 chapters are enough to train most doctors. That is what we use for our PGs. So finally, I thank my alma mater for holding me one more time. Quite nostalgic for me. Thanks a lot, Jayaprakash, Kadambari, and your team. And to the audience, thank you all for listening. Thank you very much. In Hindi, in Tamil, and in Malay. Over to you, Jayaprakash.
Yes, sir. So if there are some questions, I think I invite questions. If there are any questions from the participants. Dear participants, if you have any questions, you can post the questions to our speaker. So there is a message for you in the chat box.
Okay.
From Dr. Akhil Goyal.
I see only one question from Philip Raj. In this new era where everyone is talking about standardized patients and simulation, how can PCC be taught? What about online teaching? I think I've answered the question. I don't want to repeat my talk one more time.
Chat.
Through narratives and through role plays, there are very powerful stories. If it is used effectively, it has a lifelong impact on students. I'm not able to see the other question. What do you do when GYPMER nurses refuse admission to patients because they have no bystanders? I am not in GYPMER anymore, so this we have to ask the medical superintendent. So, yeah, that is true. In fact, I remember humorously, when I was a postgraduate, there was a big senior resident. There was a big fight between ward sister and one of the patients, elderly patient. He refused to give a stool sample for examination. Then she said, you sign AMA and go. I am telling you to give a stool sample for 3 days. And then the doctor is asking and you are not giving. So either give the stool specimen or get discharged. Then I went and intervened and said, what is this? I went and talked to him. He's a village munsif. No, munsif means a village headman. Headman doesn't, in his village, actually manual scavenging was there. So they do not touch human excreta. No? If at all it has to be done, he has to get his that manual scavenger from the village to come and take a sample and put it in matchbox and give. So he said, I heard him tell the nurse, I'll give you half my property, but I will not touch that thing on the, bedpan. So that's what he said. So sometimes this patient agenda is very unique to each individual. So, but sisters follow standard operating protocols. So doctors are not robots, so we have to intervene many times. So,
hello, sir.
Yes, please. Akhil Goyal. Yeah, thank you. Okay. Major challenge in incorporating these changes is absence of objectivity in assessment of crucial soft skills, otherwise identified as essential but lacking. What is not assessed is not learned. Okay. There are rubrics. I can share the links with you later, maybe. Plenty of rubrics are there. If you just Google search rubrics for assessing humanism, professionalism, patient-centered care, everything is somebody or other has put it up. So we can download the thing and modify the attributes and make a rubric. That gives quite a bit of objectivity. So it is more of introspection and self-initiated change. You know? The postgraduates, first of all, I think once you have examination to pass means the students will just learn to pass and then they'll go away. In fact, with many of the nursing staff, that's what I found in Balaji Vidyapeeth also. Whatever subject we say, it is already taught as didactic lecture and nursing curriculum. They pass the exam and they know. Know means in the level one of Miller's pyramid. But they have not ascended up to level 2, 3, 4, and however hard we push, they find it difficult to internalize because the whole curriculum for 5 years is structured like that. Know and leave. So know how and leave. So, except for the core skills which they practice. So let not IMG also end up like that. So let us do a more meaningful job. No formal exam. Each form a core group. Now, like NTTC was a passion. Nobody, we got 100 rupees honorarium for spending 10 days with the participants day and night. So it is just a passion, not because of money or anything. I'm sure each college will have some passionate people, humanistic role models. You form a team and you conduct things and you can always get some Rotary Club or some other social organization to give some awards and all that to make students learn. If not in official time, and after office hours, as extracurricular activity. It can be done. Needs motivation. In Malaysia, I can give a role model from here. Our students felt we are learning on patients, we are not doing anything. Every year they conduct a big floor show, fashion show and dance and all that performances. And they sell tickets, raise about 3 to 5 lakhs every year. And with that, they help poor patients who can't buy like a wheelchair and things like that. At least 10 or 15 families they help every year. So it's not a big thing, but at least shows that they are humanistic. So why can't Jipmer and all other places adopt this model? Form a humanistic club, try to help poor patients. Maybe engage a man who wants to be in the bed, but if you pay 100 rupees, there are professional bystanders, not to stand caretakers. You can engage some people for a few days. So instead of complaining, let us wear a green cap and think of creative solutions. My idea of sharing several colors of the spectrum, but if you see, I have hardly put a black dot at all, because once black dot, the cynicism and negativism comes, we'll never get anywhere. We'll again go back to our biomedical model where we are all experts and you score 100 out of 100 in MCQ and get a PG seat, get a DM seat, and then end up not knowing how to talk to patients. And then they throw stones at the intensive care unit, and then we blame the patients, and then we bring. What we have to realize is, in the same hospital, the other team is able to get brain dead people to donate all organs, no? All the 7 or 8 organs, and so many people are benefited. If that can be done in a corporate setup, why in ICU and cardiology or neurology or cancer, they throw stones? So we have to introspect. Obviously, something is missing. If Mohan is a network for multi-organ harvesting. If Mohan study group hospitals can do this in one section of the hospital, why in the other section they come and throw stones? So that means we are not taking care of the patient in a way they understand what is going on. So the problem is with us more than with them. They react because they have not learned medicine. This, of course, there are several stories. One story, 1 minute only it takes, which we actually, the interns orientation program and the postgraduate orientation program has all the some 24 stories. Anyone can borrow it from NTTC. Ask Mr. Jayaprakash. I'm sure he is not copyrighted also, as far as I know. He'll share with you. You can use all those materials. We developed long back in late 80s and early 90s. The role play is there. A person comes with this thumb not working, PIA. So the neurology resident knows it is TIA, transient ischemic attack, and he gives anticoagulant or antiplatelet agent. One chap just gives the injection and goes off. And then what happens is, that is a case where TIA is progressive and it goes into complete stroke in 6 hours' time. The next morning when the patient wakes up, the whole side is paralyzed. What will the patient and the relatives think? When I came walking, only the thumb was, and this fellow, stupid guy, came and gave some poison injection, and now the whole side is paralyzed. Then the relatives start throwing stones. The other chap, who is patient-centered individual and proactive person, smart guy, smart intern or smart resident, says, hey, you got a TIA, if you are lucky, it will recover. If you are unlucky, it may spread. And then call the bystanders, family people, and say, if it spread, the whole side may be affected. We'll know only after 24 hours. We'll give the medicine. They give the proactive advice and give. So in case the medicine works and he recovers, they'll say, you are God, you are perfect angel, all that, no? Which I shared with you, all the positive things they'll tell. But unfortunately, 1 in 10, it progresses. So if it progresses and it becomes a complete stroke, they'll at least say, this chap explained everything while giving injection. God willed, otherwise fate was not, Saturn was in 8th house, that is why it happened like that. They'll blame astrology or a lifeline as a cross, that was the stroke and all that. Something, they'll find some other way of meaning. Everybody wants to find meaning. So if the man gives the injection without telling them and he develops stroke, then that is the immediate triggering factor that makes meaning to them. So don't blame the patient, blame the system, blame ourselves, blame our residents for not being proactive. So this is a very important exercise which we embedded in interns orientation and also PG orientation. Even today when I meet PGs after 30 years, you can ask Ashoka if he is there in the audience. He will know. He was one of the early birds who has listened to these stories in 93-94. So they all remember those stories like that. So we have to create a positive environment and nothing to do with evaluation. Please stop objectively assessing all this. So we can assess for doctoral research. Yes, we do. For that, you can ask Varsha. We made a mixed mode approach, and there are ways of doing that objectively. Okay, then. Any other specific queries? Sorry if I appeared rude and blunt. That is the positional advantage, sitting far away in Malaysia. If I was sitting in Pondicherry, I wouldn't do that. Because the book Trick or Treat got me into enough trouble. I don't want to undergo one more round of trouble by saying such things. But it is all in good faith, so that the next generation is much better in handling patients. And we are very ready to blame the patients and get the police to come and harass them and all that, not thinking why they donate organs for brain dead people, but then this also happened. So obviously, we are dichotomized, like a schizophrenic medical fraternity.
So may okay. I ask a question? May I ask a question, sir?
Yeah, please.
This examination couch in the doctor's office has become redundant. Is it most of the time, patient, you know, I see my young PGs and interns and all just doing symptom treating, armchair docs. Are we producing that kind of doctors of the future? Examination couch is not used very often. It is not used. It's become a piece of furniture in the doctor's office.
Yeah, that is. Who are the role models? You go to any specialist clinic now. My cousin or someone was saying yesterday in India they went to see a doctor. No, my professional colleague, he is in the audience. Doctor, can you tell your experience of going to a cardiologist and getting all the investigations done and then spending 3 minutes of disposal? They call it disposal. I don't know. He must be in the audience somewhere.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You're better that you tell rather than I reflect what you told me yesterday.
More than my personal experience, we found many patients who are waiting there for the whole day. Actually, they have come in early in the morning. They are given a bunch of investigations, not by the consultant, but by a physician assistant. They do a complete workup, and then they have to wait. In fact, some of the hospitals have got a double queue system, where again you have to queue up to be seen by the consultant. The single consultant is seeing, I was surprised because it's completely unlike what is in the medical colleges. A single consultant is seeing the patient and sometimes they're waiting almost till the evening to be seen in a very short period. So I really wonder how you have to spend, how do you develop this humanism, rapport in such a short span? So it is more like a one shot sitting in an armchair and disposing of cases. I've done a system study where we looked at another hospital and seen how many patients are actually seen by a consultant. And in a given day, it sometimes ranges anything from 50 to 60. If you do a time analysis, each patient is getting about on an average 5 minutes. That's it. And this is, I'm not talking for a general patient. It is for a super specialty patient. So I think that's what has happened. You may say that's how it is, overcrowd. No, it's not a question of overcrowding. We have to look at a wider perspective, more people sharing, distributing the burden rather than saying, no, I shall see everybody. I hope I clarified.
Patient.
Was I audible?
Yes, sir. Patient satisfaction surveys, do they really, reflect the actual situation? Patient satisfaction?
Yeah, definitely. And NHS and all the other places, patient reported satisfaction is much more weighted than doctor reported or other reported, because they are the end users. Just like student reported satisfaction, we ignore it in India, but in Malaysia it is a big deal. All promotions, pay rise, everything is dependent on what we call as SATE, SATE we call it, student assessment of teacher effectiveness. We may think we are effective, but if we are not getting across to students, they give us low feedback. And sometimes those who get low, they start arguing also against student feedback. What do they know about the subject? They may not know about subject, that we are the gurus, but they are the recipients. So if it is, we are not effective in what they perceive, that means something is wrong. So we need an educationist to sit and assess what is going wrong and try to improve ourselves. Then we also have to realize that the Johari window concept, J-O-H-A-R-I, those who have, don't know earlier, you can Google it and see, Johari. Four windows are there. What is public knowledge about me, that you know and I know? What is private knowledge, only I know is secrets. And what neither of us know is my potential, which will come out only when I'm pressed for some, like COVID pandemic and all that, some new facets will emerge. And the last window, hidden window, is what others know, but I don't know. So when we teach, students know something which we are may not be aware. Our tics, our mannerisms, our things, many times we don't know. They will say, oh, sir, you told okay 110 times. Or you said very good 55 times. You know, they do frequency count. We, I have done that as student also. So these things, some are of course not much important, but what I mean is there are other important feedback they can give. So definitely user and end user feedback, whether it is students that we teach or patients we treat, has to be given weightage. If it is not getting across, that means communication. That's why I said humanism is the driver and communication skill is the vehicle that delivers. Both need to be there. Communication skill alone without is not enough.
The tone of voice of the doctor or the teachers also makes a big difference. The tone of voice we use with the patients.
True. Absolutely. It has to be different. Even with students, if they are free to make mistakes and learn, they'll be more open. Often what happens if they make a mistake, we make fun of them in front of their peer group, which is not acceptable to them. So like in Malaysia, they nobody asks questions because of this.
And here nobody asks.
Nobody answers. Yeah, nobody answers. In private, if you ask, sir, yes, we'll make a fool of ourselves and then it will go into the Facebook, Instagram, everywhere. Earlier, the fellows only, it was grapevine gossip in the mess. Now immediately it will be recorded on Instagram and put to the whole world. So they are much more sensitive.
Yes.
Yeah, that is a problem.
Thank you, sir.
Even a mark sheet, which I used to put a rank and all that earlier, top rankers, I remember as dean 10 years back in Malaysia, I used to sign, well done, keep it up and all that on the mark sheet itself. Nobody minded into up to 2010. But after social media has come in a big way, because people who got high scores, they take an immediate camera shot and put it on Instagram and Facebook. So other students who got low marks, they get offended. So now it is all anonymized. We give only individual score to people, you come and see your sheet. The marks are only coded and put up. So if they know their code number, they know their marks. So that is how its system works now. Things are different. What worked 10 years back doesn't work anymore. Absolutely right, Doctor. Thank you for sharing that.
Good afternoon, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, very well. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much for your excellent presentation, particularly the holistic and humanistic approach and your beautiful illustrations as usual. And we miss you, all those things, actually. I miss personally. And sir, regarding the communication skills, and in fact, we in our university, RCMP, we have incorporated communication skills from year one itself. we have got the specific classes for communication skills, and in fact I am also involved in communication skills from year 1 to year 3. And today we have got some demonstration for that, and your lecture today, it will help me a lot while taking this communication skills class for year 1 students particularly, because they are quite novice. And so thank you very much, sir, for your today's presentation. I'm lucky to get enrolled and listen to you. And good afternoon, Prof. Narayan.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Mohanty. He is from Ipoh in Malaysia, a former colleague who worked with us at the university, senior pharmacologist and editor of prestigious journal from Ipoh. So if you want an international publication, please send to him. You go to RCMP Ipoh, you will get the link and you can submit your articles. Thanks, Mohanty. Maybe I'll
thank
write
you.
An article and give you in the next issue, for December issue.
Yes, sir. Your article was so, the timing and so pertinent. That was the only article for our June issue, sir. And I'm really thankful and grateful to you, sir, and also communicating this message to others now, to the audience. That's why I'm very, very thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, then all the best. Keep in touch.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Is Dr. DK is around by any chance? May not be. Dr. Anathakrishnan was there. I saw him briefly. DK?
I am there. I am very much there.
Yes, you have to say something. You are my senior colleague.
No, I enjoyed it as usual. Because communication is one aspect that we ignore right from the beginning to the end. And I personally feel that the 8COM module of the MCI is not going to make much change, because their whole approach is of those who have not understood what communication means. Maybe it will improve in future, and those who are aware will spend time with the students right from first year, because that contributes a lot to the perception of the qualified physician, which they don't understand. Knowledge perhaps does not contribute as much as communication skills. So it's a very topical discussion, and I hope the message has got across.
Thank you, AK. That's why in the JIPMER meeting earlier, I said that EdCom module and the MCI document is wabi-sabi.
Yeah.
It's a half-baked one, but better to have half-baked one rather than a fully-baked one. That will come later in the next edition. I think probably it will improve.
No, but
creating waves in the sense Malaysia is copying that and trying to refine. So probably our version may be better baked than the one. Yeah. I also found what you said, that communication skills is weak. And secondly, it will all end up in documentation and objectively assessing and passing and this and that. So the main purpose of cultivating and internalizing the skills, that aspect is lost.
No, but the problem with these half-baked ones is, if you develop a distaste, when the fully baked one comes, you may not like to taste at all.
That is a risk.
I have a question, please. Hello?
Yeah, a little louder, please. I can hear you, but not too well.
Sir, can you hear me? Am I audible,
Dr. Raghu, Raghu Murthy, yes.
Yeah. I just want to have a small doubt. So in this current technology-driven world, and you were just mentioning EdCom models just now. Sir, in the EdCom models, just have seen that most of the time when we are teaching the undergraduate students, sir, usually the students are they are taking the the senior lecturer or professor or whatever it is as their role models. So they are trying to copy anything from the role model. So whatever it is, so we cannot put entirely on the students as they did not learn well. So their communication skills are weak. So what I wanted to just clarify is, we have to ourselves first change ourselves, so that when we converse with the patients, or how we converse with the students, that will be go on to the students, they will exactly copy the same thing. So first we have to correct ourselves, and then we have to do the rest. What that is what I feel.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100%. The teacher has to evolve to a role model so that this, even if it is implicit curriculum, not explicit curriculum, it will penetrate. Sometimes negative role models also we can use.
Yes.
Yes.
If we don't spend much time with the patients, the same thing that will be copied by the students also.
In fact, I was failed in my medicine paper by the same patient whom I showed. No, I was too poor to kill myself. That boy, he was given to me as a long case, splenomegaly, in a send-up exam, pre-final thing in the final year. And unfortunately, what happened is I knew him so well. I wrote all the history, examination, finding, everything. And then just checked the cursorily splenic size, whether it is bigger or less. Then in lung case, you know, we have to those days do a blood smear and show the leukemic cells and all that. And that chap was sitting for the, my name is S. So I came on the fourth day or something. Past 4 days, they have been pricking me left and right. Sir, can you use the use? So he had kept the previous day's slide with him. Oh, I can avoid one prick. Then I felt bad and I took that slide and mounted it and showed the leukemic cells. Unfortunately, what happened is that slide was broken on one edge. The professor knew that it's a broken slide was used by the student previous day. He asked, did you stain this fellow? I said, no, I took, the patient gave me yesterday's slide. I didn't feel like pricking him. His whole hand was like pincushion. Every student coming and pricking, so I didn't do that. I thought he will accept it, but instead he said, you are arrogant, you are insolent, and then he put F mark and sent me off. No? If I report to the director, you won't be allowed this time. Anyway, it's okay, you are not supposed to do all this, do you know? Etc., etc. So, sometimes patient-centered care, if your teachers are blind, it will be counterproductive. But instead of making me cynical, I said, okay, when my time comes, I'll make a change. So that's what
yeah,
I did.
That
you
message
can use it
will
as a motivational point rather than a demotivating point. I failed in final year, long case because of that. I made up because I did very well in the short case.
And one more thing, sir, because like why one of our madam told like why the couch has been not at all used, because now as every patient comes inside the ward, the first thing they will ask is what is your symptoms, okay, do this test and come. So there is no time for spending the using the couch at all. So because of this technology driven ward, most of the that first hand rule of using that the whatever the methods for this one, that one, we are almost forgot in this age.
Could I share one more anecdote?
Yeah,
yes.
Sure.
This is actually not mine. It's Dr. D.K. Srinivas. He's somewhere in the audience, probably is watching on YouTube. Some time back, he shared this story with me. he was training physiotherapy students, teachers, and they were conducting for OSCE. And some of the OSCEs were with reference to communication skills. So and that got implemented. And much later, they realized that actually the patient attendance in the hospital has gone up. And then they tried to find out why that has happened, something like collateral benefit. And they found that because of this introduction of OSCE and assessment of the communication skills, the students had imbibed that quality and they were communicating better with the patients. And because they were communicating better with the patients, the overall hospital attendance or the clinic attendance had gone up. So sometimes we are not able to see the benefits immediately and the benefits come somewhere else. So this was an anecdote which Dr. Srinivas had shared with me some time back. I thought since he's not been able to respond in this forum, I thought I'll share it with you all. Thank you.
Actually, sir, what I feel like, if we can embed in our curriculum these communication skills, the students from the very beginning, they know something about communication skills. For example, there are so many, you know, there is a particular method how to teach communication skills, not that what we do or what we say, how we say, the students will just adopt it. They must learn particular way, because it is something has to be learned from the very beginning, communication skills. But I don't know in MCI or Indian curriculum, this communication skills anywhere it is embedded in our curriculum, MBBS curriculum. So we have to think of it and from the very beginning, okay, that is definitely because of our overburdening of the patient. Sometimes we don't get time to communicate with the patients properly or adequately. But if it is there in our mind, how to communicate, then I think, you know, this non-verbal behavior, all those things, tone of voice, and all those things, like, you know, that's what we are going to teach today, like Mehrabian's communications model. And there are so many models, and Sir now also demonstrated so many things. So we have to give a serious thought for our Indian curriculum. Thank you.
So may I say something?
Please.
You know, in community medicine, communication in health education is a chapter itself. And every intern, when they finish, by the time they finish their internship, they are supposed to prepare a poster, do a health education session in whichever posting, whether it's a rural area, urban area, or in the PhDs, they have to do this. So this health education is one big chapter in community medicine itself. And not many doctors, you know, after they finish, you know, really get the, you know, talk to the patients about how to take the medicines, how to even open a eye drop vial, you know, and put the dropper, how to put the eye drops into the eyes, you know, and how, why it's necessary for them to take the full course of antibiotics. Not many people spend a lot of time for them, you know, in that kind of the thing. I think this has to change when seniors do this, and then the juniors copy it, and it has to be inbuilt, the thing that you have to, or you should have some counselors who can, if the doctor has no time, there should be counselors to, you know, educate them even about what operation they are going to go through. This, I've seen the system in Arvind Eye Hospital. They have this Arvind Eye Hospital where the doctor gives all the things in the record, and the counselor chats with the patient and answers their questions and everything. And, you know, it's a beautiful system which needs to be incorporated in every discipline of every consultant's, the same, you know, every, I mean, department of the hospital.
But I have a small thing to ask you, sir. Greetings from Jipmer. I'm Dr. Sivaraman from Jipmer.
Yeah.
Nice to see you back, sir. I heard the entire webinar. It was very nice. So I have a small thing to ask you, sir. When we do very good patient-centered care, what happens exactly is patient somehow takes our phone number and keeps calling us and keeps waiting for us even on untimes. What is your idea to, what is your experience to circumvent all these problems, sir?
Advantages, I still get some queries from India. Some
yes.
Diehard patients are still asking me doubts, but not too many. And other thing is, they can't call because international. No? So they
including
send
me
message on WhatsApp or Facebook Messenger. And asynchronous communication is possible. But if they expect 24/7, that's why I said, you know, patient care. Patient-centered care, patients even in the West expect 24/7 connectivity, which is not possible. So we have to draw lines. You have to tell, you know, beyond this, it is not possible. So especially dependent patients will start bugging. So dependent patients depend on you more and more, even for non-medical problems, they'll want you to solve it for them. So, it is a problem. So I used to face that also. So I used to quite early in the thing, sometimes I tell them, this is it and no more. So,
thank you, sir. Thank you for that explanation. I have one more thing. Actually, when patients deny something that we have already told, sometimes we don't document things properly. Like this, we might call you for an operation theater on this particular date. But we may get a slot earlier or later. When we get the slot earlier, they make it a point that yes, they come only because we have called. So they make us responsible for most of the things when we schedule the patients earlier. Or when the patient operation theater date gets a little later, I'm asking you a little specific questions which I am facing in my clinic so that I'll get your experience. Maybe this is concerned with patient care, that's why I'm asking, sir.
We had this problem when I was in Trivandrum for 3 years as lecturer in cardiology. The waiting list for several years for routine surgery. Sometimes 3 years waiting for ASD closure and all that. So we used to have this thing. But sometimes because the patient has got fever or not able to arrange blood donors and all that, the thing will get cancelled. So I had a RAC list, reservation against cancellation. But I'll specifically tell them, RAC you will only get 3 days notice. On Friday, surgery will be anytime in the next week, so can you come? So if they commit, then I get a kind of OPD sheet itself, signature that I'm willing to come on RAC quota, short notice, so if there is a cancellation. So on every Friday, the cardiac surgeons will admit and inform us there is any vacancy, and the cardiac physicians have to supply cases. So I used to call them. And then the other way, sometimes postponement also will be there. The surgeon goes on leave or there is an infection and all. That was more difficult. But at that time, I don't know if it works now. 90% of pre-op cases used to have eosinophilia. So you can just say that your eosinophil count is high. Anesthesia people are particular that you are in pink of health before coming. So take 21 days of etrazone and come. So 3 weeks of etrazone. That gave us a buffer to find space to admit that. So sometimes workaround strategy has to be done so that, I don't know. So in your own situation, you have to find some solutions, I think. I'm sharing what I used to do from 1978 to 81, 3 years.
So Kadambri here, sir.
Yes, Kadam.
Sir,
you are
I have
a co-organizer. Yes, please carry on.
I have a very basic question.
Yeah.
Why has it become necessary now to teach specifically communication skills and find a place for it in the curriculum after so many centuries of practicing medicine? Is it that we have, over the years, we have deteriorated in our communication skills? Is it that? Or is it just that we have become aware of the need to have a specific focus on it? I hope I'm clear, sir.
Yeah, sure. No, there are several things now at society level because of this power of information. No, there is no need to depend on paternalistic model. Earlier, you can behave like Dr. House in Escape. If you see Dr. House episode, you will know how rude he is and all that. So generally, what medical anthropologists say is the more narrower specialty you are and you are well known globally for being expert in some particular field, and patients will tolerate and forgive all the idiosyncrasies, including rudeness and all you have. But as you go become more and more generalized, like general surgeon, pediatrics, general physician and all that, there are thousands of us in India. So you have nothing unique that may attracts patients to a particular person except that rapport building skills and communication skills. So in order to retain the patient lifelong, to come to you for checkup and healthcare and all that, you need to have this rapport. So it has become more important. If you act like Dr. Hauser as a general surgeon or a general physician, they will not come. They are more humoristic counterparts elsewhere, so they will go away. And secondly, patients are more autonomous now. Unlike earlier, they were more what they call as perfect angel model. In Jipper, you would have known when you were training earlier and all that, they'd say Sami. You know, even the doctors, they used to call us Sami. Even while calling is Sami means God. So Sami only. Even when I was a PG, they used to say, I used to go and practice this. Now, don't you want to know what is wrong with that? I still remember the case of another case of TML. husband and wife were there. In the evening, I went and asked them, you want to know what is going on and what is being done? He said, nothing. We have absolute faith in this hospital and absolute faith in you and your all the big doctors that you come along with you in the morning. Even if you kill both of us, we'll accept it as. No, that kind of blind acceptance that we will only do good to them. And if we kill them, that will be with a purpose in mind, not willful harm. So that kind of faith I had seen in 70s and all that, I don't think it is there anymore. Maybe in village, some villages might have, but most of the other places, it is not there anymore. Society has changed, so communication skill has become important. Meanwhile, medical knowledge and science has exploded so much, they are squeezing more and more into 4.5 year curriculum. The advantage in Malaysia is most of the colleges, 30 to 40% of curriculum is human basis of medicine in year one. So it is not just crowded, everything else is crowded out by anatomy, physiology, biochem in India. Whereas here it is less strenuous basic science and the more of human basis of medicine embedded. So that is why Mohanty is able to teach communication skill. We also do here. 8 2-hour sessions are there. Communication skills in year one. I used to take 4 of them and Dr. Narayan used to take the remaining 4. Now we are super seniors, so other people are now taking. So once in a way, I now take 1 session out of 8. So there is space, so we can create space. If Malaysia can create, why not Indian medical curriculum, especially when the new MCA is asking us to do so.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Kadam. I'm expecting a lot from Dr. Kadam and Dr. Zaya because you are an innovative medical college and head of DME, which is famous for National Teacher Training Center ethos. Make a new curriculum and maybe launch some online training of trainers on communication and various other soft skills training.
Yes, sir. Jipmer, we have introduced this communication skill in a longitudinal thing. Sir, starting from foundation course, we are inculcating this communication skill to our students. Sir. And so this year we have
training of trainers. Training of trainers to train medical teachers on soft skill development. We created medical education team, 3 from each college. We'll take 4 or 5 from each college at a time. Spend 3 or 4 days. Master trainers workshop provide all the skills and tools of how to teach effectively. And over initially, they'll all laugh at them when they go back. But after 10-20 years, just like medical education is now very sacred to everybody, to become sacred for. Whereas I know NTTC in 70s, Dr. Anantakrishnan will go. They used to laugh. Hey, you teach well. Why do you want to join NTTC? So even to me, my professor said, you are a good teacher, that's what students tell me. Why do you want to get spoiled by NTTC? So that is a kind of... So now the same thing will be applied to soft skills development for some time.
Yes, sir.
But we can go past that.
If there are no more questions, I think we can conclude the session, sir.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So. When Jayaprakash and Kadam suggested this name, I don't know how they came across. They only said teaching learning of patient-centered care. Because I have not spoken this topic either in Balaji Vidyapeeth or any other forum earlier. It was totally new. So
yes, sir,
I just shared it with him and Jayaprakash immediately said, you please choose a topic of your choice, we'll accommodate. Then I said, no, not for ATTC. So, because plus a new topic means new challenge, you know. Because of this, I spent about 20 days reading up almost 70 articles and choosing about 15-20 of them, I think. Every slide has an article link. So about 25 articles probably were there. Finally shortlisted and then 1 slide of each. Then some stories to accompany. Very good. I spent about 15-20 days preparing this. Because lockdown phase, nothing else to do. So, this is a totally new PowerPoint.
We want you to So specifically, we want you to talk on this topic because we want you to share your experience. Now you have rightly shared your experiences, citing all in the form of narratives. So this is one way we also learn how to share our experience so that people will learn. And people like you should document all your experience. So that is why this is an opportunity for you, and we have set the stage for that.
Okay, thanks a lot. If you need any more association with me and former alma mater, you are always welcome.
Sure,
nostalgia, and good to link up with alma mater for 40 years.
Yes, sir. So I take this opportunity to thank you for joining with us in this national webinar, and I also thank our participants for joining us and for their contribution. And you had a lot of patience to answer the queries of our participants. You very well started the session by quoting the verses from Charaka, and you lucidly explained the concept of what is patient-centered care, and the purpose of patient-centered care, and the factors that influence the adoption of patient-centered care. And the best part of your explanation, which I personally liked, is that the difference between humanism and professionalism, which you explained through narratives, your own experience and narratives. That was really wonderful. That is a model how teachers can use narratives for teaching professionalism. That was the best part of this. And finally, you explained the importance of communication skills and the basics of patient-centered communication skill, and why it needs to be taught for the present generation students. In those days when the students were less and the students had a lot of access to their mentors and teachers, but nowadays, because of mushroom growth of colleges and more number of students, we need to, as one of the participants said, that we need to have a structured approach for communication skill. That was explained by you, sir. And you also identified the best teaching learning strategies for transacting this patient-centered patient-centered care and patient-centered professionalism. And your take-home message was also very, very clear, as you started by saying, a physician who fails to enter the body of a patient with a lamp of knowledge and understanding can never treat the disease. So by saying this, I also wanted to conclude this session by saying that. And your take-home message was really clear. If you want to achieve patient-centered care curriculum, successfully, you need to use both the humanistic approach as well as the scientific approach. So just humanistic approach will not help, as well as scientific approach alone will not help in inculcating the patient-centered professionalism. So both these approaches need to be mixed in an eclectic way so that we can achieve the goals of patient-centered care. So I think the participants would have taken the take-home message clearly, and they will take this message forward and apply it in their day-to-day teaching learning activities. With this, I thank all the participants and thank our speakers. So thank you very much, sir, for joining us, and we'll meet in another forum, sir.
Thanks a lot. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
We made a lot of new contacts today. So yes, thanks, especially to the new friends.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.